Hi, it's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. I'm sitting here with my friend Matt Starr. How are you, mate?
Nice to see you.
Good to see you. We're at Spitfire, my studio.
Yes.
Where we've recorded a lot of stuff over the years.
We have.
We did, how did we first meet? Was it because of Ace?
Ace. I was on the phone with Ace and he said, hey, we need somebody to mix the record. We were listening to mixes by a few guys. It wasn't really working. And I said, okay. And then just then, our friend Phil walked by and I said, hold on. And I said, hey, Phil, do you know any guys? He goes, yeah, Warren, who are? I'll give you his info.
Who's Phil?
Phil from Swing House.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Yay, go Phil.
Yep, that's how, and that was literally like, we need a guy. And I'm like, I think that guy knows everybody. Hey, Phil. And he gave me your name.
You know what? I never knew that.
Yeah.
Because I know that Ace got hold of Jack
mm-hmm.
and said, who should I get to mix it? So maybe, yeah. Maybe they needed the two people to have the same name.
Yeah.
That. Have we stumbled upon a secret there? Just had, if you get two recommendations, you're going to get the gig.
That's a really important thing. Like two or three, just come at it from all angles. Because I don't know if you find that, but it's like mm-hmm. if somebody's name keeps coming up and you go, okay, right. I keep hearing this from reputable sources. Okay, might as well follow it then.
So I got you to thank, Phil to thank, and Jack to thank.
Yeah.
That was great. So you came, what tracks did we do? Did you play on? Because we came in and retracked some drums and we
did some strums. The record that you, the first one that you mixed, Space Invader, I played on everything.
Oh, right,
so I played
cool.
on the whole record, yeah. But we had recorded that at several different locations.
I didn't know.
So Kevin Churko's place in Vegas, at a studio up in Northern California.
Nice.
Some songs here, right?
Yes. What were the songs we did here? Do you remember?
Some of the songs on the record. I don't remember. No, I don't.
I don't remember either. And yeah. I recorded them.
Yeah.
But that was fun. You know, Ace is a very talented, but B, incredibly generous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, he always gives, and this is a good thing to talk about. He always gives credit to everybody involved.
He absolutely does. I never felt like, I only felt like I was in the room with a guitar player and a songwriter. You know, only when I would go, oh, right, that's Ace Frehley, was I reminded of who he is. But he doesn't remind you of that. He just is working, wants to get a good tone, wants to make the songs right. And it's something also I learned from him is just the pace is just so, he works really hard and he works long, but he just works relaxed.
Yeah.
You know, headphones weren't right. And I was like, you know what? That's cool. I got it. He goes, no, make sure they're right. Go ahead. Tell the guy what you need. You know, just very relaxed. And that's really conducive to creativity. Because sometimes we can, you know, as a hired guy, I can come in and go, I want to be efficient. I know everybody's paying for this. I want to, you know, really give them the money's worth. And yeah, but you're, In the mindset, that might take you another 120 seconds. The actual work that comes out is going to be much more valuable. So that's definitely something I learned.
I think that might be something to do with an era because Jack's the same way. Jack Douglas is the same way. He makes everybody in the room feel important and comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed with Aerosmith, he made every member, Tom, Brad, you know, Joey, Joe and Steven all feel completely equal. There was not like, the reason why I did it in that order, because it wasn't like rock stars, super famous,
right.
Down. Everybody's opinion mattered.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's probably that, you know, because Ace would have done records with Bob Ezrin.
Right.
And Bob, of course, is a big mentor for Jack as well.
Mm-hmm.
I think Bob gave Jack his first break on, may have been Alice, but basically Bob was double booked on so many records in the 70s, you know, being so successful, that he gave Jack a record.
Jack involved in Muscle of Love?
It may have been.
I think that.
I'm getting a thumbs up from Pablo.
Yeah.
Over there.
Oh.
There you go. Pablo, our resident expert on the 70s.
Expert on all things.
So I think that's a good lesson. It's a good thing to talk about. It's like working with these guys. The other thing actually really impressed me about Ace was like he was sending me files. He's like, send you the files to this song because
mm-hmm.
he was in San Diego. So, you know, do a mix, send it to me, and I'm going to test you out.
Mm-hmm.
Sending me a song.
Yeah.
So, obviously, you know, we're talking an old rock star here. I was assuming what he meant was my guy,
right.
Johnny or whatever, is going to edit it and send it to you. And of course, you know, I get the files and the regions are consolidated and everything's removed and it's just mix ready.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh, cool, nice and professional. So he's like, once we get it, like after a recall or two, and he's really happy, he's like, okay, I'm going to drive up and hang out with you for a couple of days, stay in a hotel and bring the files. So I'm like, okay, cool.
Yeah.
So he drives up, he pulls in, he takes out his tower, sets it up on the table with a huge screen, mm-hmm. and he's the frickin' Pro Tools editor.
Right.
He's comping all the guitar solos. Mm-hmm. He's comping, like, taking a drum fill and putting it where he wants and everything.
Right.
And he knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, this guy's like in his 60s, he's been doing this whole life, and he's as good at Pro Tools as anybody that works for me.
Yeah. Yeah, he's super tech savvy, and he actually had a laptop. He had met somebody at IBM or, you know, one of those big computer companies in the 80s. They had right. given him this, like, early. So he's always been into technology and all that stuff. So, yeah.
See, you'd never have guessed that.
Right.
When you're
right.
talking like 70s rock star, you think, you know, because you think, oh, they're so pampered, they don't need to do anything. Mm-hmm. And to see a guy that knows Pro Tools inside and out and is editing his own stuff.
Right.
And, he's the producer, he's engineering, you know, Chris Wise, you know, obviously Chris came and played bass mm-hmm. at Ace's home studio. And right. Chris is, and Ace is the producer engineer mm-hmm. of that.
It's, yeah.
And he's engineering his own guitar solos and stuff right. like that at his right. house and flying them off to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty remarkable. So we had a lot of fun making that record, mm-hmm, the yeah. first one, and then, of course, the second one.
Right.
Which was a lot of fun because we did Fire and Water.
That was awesome. Yeah, Ace called me the night before and said, hey, are you around tomorrow? I said, yeah. He goes, okay.
From here?
Yeah. So you might be doing something. I said, yeah, I'm around. So I said, okay, cool. And he called me in the morning. He goes, I just got off the phone with Paul. I said, okay, I'm liking where this phone call is going.
Right.
And he said, do you know Fire and Water by Frey? I said, yep, I do. And he goes, okay, well, we're going to track that and Paul's going to sing. So that was a really cool experience.
It was like right near the end of the record.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we'd already had like all the Lita Ford and John Five mm-hmm. and a whole bunch of other Slash, of course.
Slash came in that yeah. day, right? No, he came in on another day.
I think yeah. he came in like a couple of days before.
Rock and Roll Hell he came in on.
Yeah. So yeah. we'd had all this great stuff. And it was just like one of those, oh yeah, I called Paul and he says he wants to do a song. And mm-hmm. We both really like Fire and Water. It was like just one of those. And then boom, yeah, next day you're in playing drums.
Yeah.
We're doing guitar overdubs. Mm-hmm. And he drives back home that weekend for something to see his girl. And Chris puts bass down mm-hmm. after just getting out of hospital.
Yeah.
Puts bass down. And then the vocals, like Greg Collins tracked the vocals like over the weekend. On Monday we mixed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was like 2 days before the deadline of the record. Yeah. It's just like feels like when you're a kid and you look at these things, you think everything is so like organized and perfect and whatever.
Right.
Things just, you know, schnizzle just happens.
Yeah, they just happen. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's nice when that chemistry gets happening and things just come together. Timing yeah. is right, you know, because, you know, the guys like that, they're busy. So yeah. someone might want to do something, but they're not available. And so it's cool. And that was fun, you know, from a drummer perspective. On that record, because there's a lot of songs that I played on that I knew all the songs already, and especially like the Kiss ones. And so how do I put my own stamp on that?
Right.
But also acknowledge the parts that need to be there.
Sure.
You know, and Rock and Roll Hell is one of those ones that has that Pat Boone, Debbie Boone fill over everything. Pat yeah. Boom, 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 boom. And I tried to get away from that fill, and I couldn't. I mean, that's one of the best fills ever.
Who's the drummer on that record?
Eric Carr.
Oh, Eric.
Yeah,
oh,
so it was off Creatures of Night, like 83. And there were some other things where there was some leeway, but that sets up every verse. Mm-hmm. And I just said, you know what? I can't change that, you know? But that's the
navigation. How blind, you know?
Right, right. You're not going to argue if it works. It's like, hey,
right.
you know?
Well, it was a lot of fun. And what's crazy is we did it, you know, in there. Mm-hmm. And it was, and I'm, when we sent the files, we sent stems to Greg Collins, and he immediately emailed me back. It was like, wow, who played drums and where did you record it?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, it was Matt Starr, and we recorded it in a room that's like 12 foot by 15.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a little bit of a vaulted ceiling, so I suppose it's not super high, but it's high enough to get a little bit out of it. But I don't use any room mics because they just sound like bad phasing.
Right.
We just, you know, bit of reverb.
Mm-hmm.
And God bless America. And it's funny. I like talking about that because it just illustrates that you just need the talent and the creativity to create something great. I mean,
right.
obviously, I'd love to go to Olympic in the 60s and, you know, track in the big room there and get those great drum sounds, you know, the Zeppelin stuff. And even when the Beatles were over there, some of those room tones you can just hear so well. Mm-hmm. I think Tomorrow Never Knows was done there, for instance. And that drum sound. So I'd love to be able to do that, but that isn't available to all of us these days.
Right.
So here we can. You come here all the time, and we track in a tiny room on a 64 Ludwig.
Yeah.
Which costs $400 from Craigslist.
Wow. Yeah.
God bless Craigslist.
Yeah.
So tell, you know, enough about me. Tell me a little bit about your journey. I actually don't know all of the details. Where are you from originally, and how did you get here?
Grew up in Connecticut. Saw Kiss. I was bitten by the Kiss bug when I was like 8 years old. My mom and dad were super cool. Took me and half the neighborhood
really?
To see Kiss. In 1979, Dynasty tour, Judas Priest opened up.
Wow.
Yeah. And
pre-British steel, yeah?
Yeah, and they were not well received. I remember that. And I remember getting into Priest several years later and thinking, oh, they have a different singer, because when I saw him, the guy had long hair, so it was another guy. And I didn't realize that it was Rob Halford. And I thought, if you had long hair, why on earth would you cut it? You know, so that had to be two different guys. but yeah, you know, that was the thing. And the first record I ever got was a Sean Cassidy record with the Do Run Run, which is an awesome song. And it's actually still a great record. But I got that. And then my neighbor had a Kiss Destroyer. Mm-hmm. And I got that. I went to the Caldors, which is like the Walmart back in the day in Connecticut. Sure. Bought that record. And I was not a destructive kid, but something told me I had to dispose of the Sean Cassidy record. And I'm not joking. And I didn't have any friends. I didn't tell anybody. I broke it in half and threw it in the trash.
Right.
And now full disclosure, I bought that record twice. I have a big vinyl collection. I have the original copy and a promo copy. So it's a great record. But as a kid, I just was like, you know what? If I'm into this, I can't. I'm just drawing a line. So sure. I wasn't very nuanced then, but it was like, this is my thing.
Sure.
You know, so it was Kiss, Cheap Trick, Aerosmith. It was Kiss Alive, Cheap Trick Live, Budokan, Aerosmith Live Bootleg, mm-hmm. Iron Maiden, Number of the Beast, Highway to Hell.
Highway to Hell.
So all that was like the beginning of my drum journey. Mm-hmm. I love rock and roll. And then in the 80s, it was Tommy Lee, Motley Crue, Guns N' Roses, that first record. And there was a couple other bands in that era, Love Hate, which I went on to play with about 20 years later. But then I went backwards and I got into Zeppelin, you know, through the drummers. So I like John Bonham, I said, okay, I'm going to get into Led Zeppelin. And I went to the mall and they had a box set with the crop circles on it. And it was $80. Now I had never spent more than, you know, $15 on a piece of music. And I said, $80, God. And I kind of deliberated over it. And then I said, well, drum lessons are about $30 a piece. Do you think there's three drum lessons in this? And I said, yeah. So I bought it. And then I was off and running. So now, you know, Bonham is definitely the top of the list. But, you know, so then it was Mitch Mitchell, Hendrix, Ginger Baker, Cream, Humble Pie, Free, all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
You know, so I love that era. I love rock and roll. The 50s is the best, and Little Richard is still the most potent, scary, sexy music ever. You know? But when those British guys that grew up on that black music, but then they just turned it up, and they did a little more drugs, and it kind of just got amplified. So Humble Pie and Free, the way that sounds, just is to me. That's Zeppelin has moments of that. It's just that's the most exciting stuff for me. You know.
Yeah, I agree. Mike Bloomfield said that the English took American music and sold it back to the Americans.
Right.
You know, it all came from America.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because, you know, when I first started working with Jack, it was pretty scary for me because being English, making music and falling in love with music at the same period of you as you, it was like late 70s, early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
All of the records we were influenced in England were all made in the late 60s and the 70s in New York.
Right.
Or Detroit. And they were the Stooges, they were the Velvet Underground. Mm-hmm. That was what created New York Dolls, of course, Patti Smith.
Yeah.
So that's what created punk and new wave mm-hmm. in England.
Right.
So it all came from America. So it's weird. So the guys that are another 20 years older than me, when they were kids in the 50s and 60s, were listening to American rock and roll and American blues and American jazz to create that. So it's interesting. America has always been the reason why British musicians have created music. We've always just taken it, but we've, you know, whatever it is in the diet or the lack of sun and the rain,
yeah,
we just twist it and it comes out the other side.
Yeah, I think there's a bluntness to America and there's a subtlety to England. So that's like a relationship that we have that we keep right. kind of batting it back and forth.
And it might also be just as obvious as that is that, you know, the Velvet Underground didn't sell many records at the time, and nor did the Stooges.
Right.
We were taking something that was underground and like putting it to the forefront, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like look, even house music and dance music in England from the late 80s actually came from New York.
Right.
So, you know. Right. Well, basically, what I'm saying is we always just steal it from you anyway.
Yeah, well, we stole it back, so it's fine.
Yeah, you stole it back.
It's fine. But anyway, so that was my journey, you know, as a kid. And then in my 20s, I wanted to front, so I started, you know, getting into songwriting. And so then that, you know, brought me into like...
I did go to YouTube and see you singing.
Oh, you did?
Mm-hmm, I have seen that.
Okay, all yeah. right.
You know.
And...
you hadn't told me about that. I found it on my own.
No, yeah, I keep it a secret. You know, so then that got me into, you know, Brian Wilson and all the Phil Spector stuff and Lieber and Stoller and all the Don Kirshner art writers and stuff like that and all that. So I really love songs. And so when I'm playing drums, I'm a drummer, but really I love the song and sure. I want to hear the vocal and I want to know what it's about. And I want to understand, is it angry? Is it melancholy? Is it sad? Is it self-pitying? Like, where is it? Because that's going to affect my playing.
Sure.
You know, and so, you know, and someone that comes to mind is Keith Moon. He would always play off the vocal.
Sure.
You know, which is such a huge Mitchell. Thing. Yeah, another one. So so I did that for several years. I made a record with Mike Chapman, who's an amazing producer, you know.
Oh, which record did you with him?
I had a band called The Automatic Music Explosion. And nice so, name. Yeah, thank you. And we kind of kicked off the long names. At that point, all the names were like, you know, cracker, lit, you know, one word names.
Right.
So, and that was kind of like, my vision was like a modern Archies. So we had a female vocalist. Mm-hmm. I sang and played guitar. We had a lead guy. So everybody had a different character. And to your point, talking about Jack and making everyone feel important, we made a record and he said, what do you want to do? And I said, we want to record live. We want to play to tape. So he said, okay, let's do it. So he's got a beautiful studio in his place in Connecticut. He's got these gorgeous grounds, tennis courts, all this stuff. So we would track, we'd do a few passes, and then we go, okay, let's do the first half of that one and the second half of that. And they used the Pro Tools rig to see if it worked. And then they go, okay, give us some time, we're gonna cut the tape. And so we go out and play Frisbee. But I remember feeling like, come on, we gotta go. And I grew up making records on tape. And when I was like 15, there was a studio right down the street. They had a studio and that's how we did it. But I'd already gotten into the computer way of making, and I was impatient. And over the course of the couple weeks that we did that, I realized, relax, dude, you know,
right.
relax. And so then you get some more ideas and the creativity. And so that pace is, I think, is much more conducive to creativity as well,
sure.
you know. So I did that for a long time and ran that up the flagpole and, you know, did some stuff, but ultimately decided to go back to drums.
And for people who don't know, look him up. Mike Chapman yeah. was a songwriting production partnership called Chinny Chap.
Yeah.
It was Nicky Chinn and Michael Chapman.
Right.
And they are responsible in England for all of the Rack Records stuff,
mm-hmm.
which was all these bands like Susie Quattro, who was huge in England, absolutely huge, Canadian girl singer, like the precursor to Joan Jett.
Right. Yeah.
She was this badass, hot girl in black leather who sang rock in the 70s. It was amazing. And yeah. Blondie. They wrote Blondie and produced Blondie, Parallel
Blondie,
Lines.
Blondie, The Knack. I mean, so many songs. And Mike was one of those guys where, you know, I'm sure we had this same experience where I like that. And then you realize it's all the same person and you go, oh, okay, that's one sure. of my guys. And so for me, it was, I loved Ballroom Blitz. Mm-hmm. I loved My Sharona. I loved Heart of Glass. I loved Hot Child in the City. I loved the song sure. called, what the hell was the song called? Exile, Kiss You All Over. Like these sure. were, Hey Mickey by Tony sure. Basil. These are all songs that just got into my soul. There was this something about him. And I realized he had written and or produced all of those songs.
Sure.
I knew he was a producer and I knew Chinny Chap were writers, but I didn't know that was the same guy. And right. once I put it all together, I was like, I remember looking at the back of the record and then I just put into the computer and I'm like, that's the same guy. And I said, that's the guy.
Whatever happened to Nicky Chinn?
Did they talk about it?
No. I don't think they're in contact. I don't know if Nicky's still alive. I'm assuming he is, but yeah.
Questions and comments below. Whatever happened to Nicky Chin, Chinny Chap.
They went their own way, but I don't think Nicky's done much, you know, since then.
Probably doesn't need to. I mean, the amount of hits that those guys wrote and produced was insane through the 70s and 80s.
Yeah.
I mean, on everything.
And they were just pushing themselves out of the charts. You know what I mean? So they would just have in Germany, they would just have the top five, and then something new would come in.
Oh, no. And in the UK, when I was a kid, it was all them. Because all of those bands, like Racy, I think didn't they write that song, Some Girls Do, Some Girls? Or was that a 50s song? But anyway, they wrote like Racy, Shawadi Wadi, Suzy Quatra, like all, you know, Sweet, all of these bands were just Chinny Chap songs.
Yep.
So, and especially Rack Records at the time, which was Mickey Most's label,
dominated
mid-70s in England.
Yeah.
Just like destroyed everything. I just hit on that sort of, when I was a little kid, it was like, it was sort of a 50s throwback sort of groove with the 70s glam rock mixed together.
Yep. I love it.
That's, yeah. It was a great time.
I'd put hand claps on everything if they'd let me. You know what I mean?
It's just double snares.
Hell yeah. Yeah. Mick Tucker, one of the greatest drummers ever. Yeah. So like that is, in that moment where I go, okay, this is the guy I have to work with, this guy.
Great.
I didn't know where he was. He hadn't made a record in 10 years.
Right.
You know, so I was searching for him for literally like a month and a half and finally figured out where he was. Mm-hmm. But I was coming up with, like, I knew his wife's name. I knew his kid's name. His wife had bought a horse in Atlanta. Like, all
you were stalking him.
I felt like a creep, but I was just kept searching every single angle. I was looking through interviews that he had done. Mike now resides, and no, it didn't say, you know. So anyway, figured out he actually lived in Connecticut. And it turns out he lived down the street from my grandparents.
Oh, wow.
So, and there was this petting zoo, like a Pet Sounds kind of petting zoo that my grandma would always take me to. And across the street was this big house. And my dad goes, I remember that house. He goes, yeah, it had this big, huge gate and a driveway. And we thought Elton John lived there as a kid because it was like the biggest, nicest house in town. So,
it turned out to be his?
It turned out to be his. So I had found his address. I mailed him a demo. Then a month later, I sent the exact same thing, mailed it again. Then I was in Connecticut a month later, and I was driving down the street, and I realized, oh, right, this is, Mike lives here. So I call my wife. I go, can you look at my computer, get that address? And I went to the house. Now, in Southern Connecticut, in this area, the houses are all very nice, but they're not gated. There's just big stone walls and stuff. So I drive up this massive driveway, and there's a gate. I was like, oh, shit. So I buzz the buzzer, and someone says, hello. And there was his wife. And I said, yeah, this is Matt Starr. I'm here to see Mike Chapman. And she goes, who? Like, that was, you know, the most humbling, like I said, my name was Mickey Mouse. And she said, do you have an appointment? And I said, no. And she goes, hold on. And I was like, well, that's that. And then it went beep, and it opened. I said, okay.
Had he listened to the demo?
So I drove up.
Yeah.
She comes out. She's eating a sandwich. She goes, hey, hi. I said, you know, I'm from LA, but I grew up in Connecticut, and I sent Mike a demo. She goes, it's so weird because Mike gave this to me last night and said, hey, check these guys out. I think they're kind of cool. What do you think? I might work with them. And she goes, he's actually took our son Christian to the DMV to get his license. Can you come back in an hour? I said, yep, I can. So I drove back down, called the band and said, I got an appointment with Mike Chapman. And so
And they're like, get out of here.
Right. And what I had read, you know, was that he was a tough dude, you know, and he was a tyrant in the studio. But I'd also read that him and Nicky Chin called Mickey Most at midnight. They got his number and they wanted to work with Mickey. And they said, well, fuck it. Let's just call him. So they called him at midnight and that kicked it off. So I had that in my back pocket. If he started yelling at me, I was going to go, hey, you called Mickey Most at midnight. It's only 2 p.m. and I politely knocked on your door. So anyway, he came back and he couldn't have been sweeter. He said, hey, mate, come on. And he brought me into his studio and it just was, you know, like this, just SSL and all this stuff. And just he goes, tell me a story. Tell me what's going on. So we poured some tequila and we had a drink and we talked about it. And at the end, we shook hands. And 2 weeks later, he flew out to L.A., saw the band, and then he flew us back and we made a record. So you know, that's like one of those crazy things. But I always had that thing as a kid. Like if I wanted to do something, I was just going to figure out how to do it. And I just didn't care about anything else, you know?
Right.
So, you know, that's a good quality. Tenacious, I guess, is what they call it. You know?
No, it's very tenacious. I will add something because I think it's really important. The bit that I think that a lot of people miss is is the hard work that you have to do as well.
Yeah.
Because I heard your story there, and it impresses me. And there's been a couple of times in my life that I wouldn't have got anything without asking, because always ask.
Yeah, always.
You're not going to get anything unless you ask. It's the Wayne Gretzky quote. Everybody's used it, but you miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Right.
You know, so definitely always ask.
Yeah.
But you got to back it up with the hard work.
Yeah, you got to have the goods.
Yeah. The point is like, you're a great drummer, you're a singer, you're a songwriter, and you've worked on your craft.
Mm-hmm.
So you can come in there. A lot of the times, and I'm just trying to be helpful, people like email me 1,000 times, and then I listen to the song, and I'm like, you haven't worked on the song. You know, and I email them back and say, look, your voice needs some work. You know, you've got to work on the songs. And they're like, oh, I just need a break. And it's like, you may get that break from somebody,
mm-hmm.
but you need to do all the work. It's not just the, you know, that misconception of luck, because luck isn't, you know, you have to make your own luck. If you didn't have a quality of music that would influence one of the most successful songwriters, frankly, of all time, it wouldn't have meant anything.
Right.
Because his wife would not have buzzed you in, because she would not have heard the demo and not have thought you were good.
Mm-hmm.
That's the part of the story that I want people to hear, because I think, and I mean this because I want to be really supportive of people, but you sent a demo and you were persistent in sending it, but you sent a high quality demo that you'd spent a long time writing and recording.
Yeah.
And once again, you would not have been let in that door if they hadn't have listened to it and she hadn't already have thought, oh, this is kind of cool. Yeah, I'll meet this guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That's huge. And I think, too, another thing is just the sincerity and the humility. Like,
sure.
Yeah, I am going to find out where you live, and I am going to send that to you, and you don't reply, and I'm going to send you another one and another one, and I'm going to go knock on your door. But I'm going to say, hi, my name is Matt Starr, and, you know, I'm going to be professional and polite, because also, too, I'll meet guys that go, hey, dude, you know, if you're into gigs, man, let me know. And it's like, I wouldn't have a coffee with you. You know, just the vibe is like this phony, entitled, but not really confident thing.
Yeah.
It's like, it's okay to, I think what for me too is, you know, when the turning point when I got into back to playing drums is there's a big career in my life, part of my career where I was the most knowledgeable guy in the room. Not much happened during that.
Yeah.
Now I try my best to be the least knowledgeable guy in the room.
Yeah.
And things are going well.
I understand.
So I'm always trying to put myself in that position. And it can be uncomfortable when I'm standing in a room with Chad Smith, Kenny Aronoff, and Stephen Perkins. Like, I mean, what, you know, I mean, if they ask me what I think of something, I can offer an opinion, but I'm going to sit and listen. There is so much experience there. There's so much knowledge and information, but it can be uncomfortable,
sure.
You know, because we're here talking about, you're talking about your career, I'm talking about mine, you know, so we like to, we're comfortable talking about ourselves. We're used to being many times the center of the focus, but there's so much work that, you know, putting myself in a situation where I'm not the center of the focus.
Sure.
You know, and I think that goes also with balancing, like being a touring drummer. Okay, after the show, yes, people tell you wonderful and you sign things and they tell you thank you and all this stuff. But then when you go to soundcheck the next day, you're working for the artist that hired you and you're an employee.
Yeah, I mean, you're playing with Mr. Big, so you've got Billy Sheehan as your bass player.
Right, and so it's balancing that I'm going to, how can I bring the best, most valuable self to this team? And then afterwards, you're amazing. Oh my God, I love you. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But doing both of those things and not getting tripped out on either one of those. And I think that's like, that's real confidence, you know, genuine self-confidence.
Yeah, you're making me think of, I was just telling this story to somebody yesterday, so I'll repeat it. And you mentioned Swing House, so I think it's important. When the Stooges got back together, they were rehearsing in one room, and we had these two big stages. And in the other stage, the Chili Peppers were doing pre-production with Rick Rubin. Mm-hmm. So it was just a great time. I mean, you had the reformed remaining members of the Stooges in one room, mm-hmm. and the Chili Peppers in the other. Anthony and Rick Rubin come out like little kids and go, Iggy.
Mm-hmm.
And so you've got Rick Rubin, arguably the most, I don't know about successful, but definitely probably the wealthiest record producer in the planet.
Yeah.
You know, ran labels, stupidly rich. And Anthony Kiedis, one of the biggest, most successful rock stars of all time, standing outside the door,
mm-hmm.
waiting for the music to stop. And so we can go in there and ask Iggy, is it okay for them to come in and meet him?
Right.
And now Iggy is arguably one of the most influential musicians of all time because, you know, his brand of rock from the late 60s and early 70s is what punk rock became. And we all know, you know, he's so influential. But record size, record sales and success, I mean, not even 1/100th of those guys individually or combined. So, you know, they're obviously far more in the public eyes, more successful, much more recognizable names. But it was wonderful to see because you realize that everybody is a fan of somebody else.
Right.
And I love those kind of experiences. Another one I had like that was working with Peter Murphy. And he was rehearsing with the Bauhaus, and I was working with these Hispanic kids, these Latino kids in L.A. And Latino kids in L.A. are huge, like 80s, late 70s English fans. They love the Bauhaus, New Order, Joy Division, The Cure. And we were sitting outside. One of them was smoking or whatever, and Peter comes out, and they're all like, like this. They're like 21 years old, and they're like freaking out.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, hey, Peter, come over here. Let's meet the guys. And this kid reaches in and pulls out a CD from his bag, and of course it's about the Bauhaus.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm a big fan. Doesn't ask to sign. He just needed to prove, look, I'm a fan of yours. Like, I even have one of your CDs in my bag.
Yeah.
Completely, you know, just the fact he walked around holding the CDs. And then Peter, without blinking, told them a story of being 18 or 19 years old and going to New York for the first time and going to the Chelsea Hotel and sitting in the bar waiting for Iggy to arrive because he'd heard. It was like late 70s that Iggy was there. And he said the bar was completely empty except for this old lady with long hair at the end. And after about half an hour, the old lady ordered a drink and it's like, hey, can I get a whiskey? And he's like, that's Iggy Pop.
Yeah.
So he goes down and he starts talking to Iggy Pop. And of course, Iggy was probably broke at the time, just wanting to buy him a drink or whatever.
Right.
But the point is like, I love that. And we're all just fans of other people.
Yeah.
And if we can be in that place all the time, we can learn. Because, you know, I just mixed Cheap Trick and it was the most nerve-wracking thing of my life.
Right. Yeah. You know? Of course. You got In Color breathing down your neck and, you know, Dream Police and all the other records Jack did with him. Yeah.
And it was Jack and Joe Perry played the solo on the end. Right. It was just like, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah. I had to pretend it was nothing. It was no big deal.
Of course, whatever.
But the whole time I'm like, yeah,
I think, and that's the truly amazing, magical, beautiful part of what we do.
Right.
Is that, you know, we get to hopefully meet our heroes, work with our heroes, get paid by our heroes.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like that, and that can be a heady thing, like for musicians, artists, you know, to get paid to do their thing sometimes is just uncomfortable.
Right.
But to get paid by your heroes to do, you know what I mean? It's like, it's a lot. And so there's a lot of things to just kind of manage as a musician and drummer, coming into a situation where you don't know people. Like you said, acting, not flipping out on the person and, you know, telling them that you know every single note they ever played, but also not acting like you don't give a shit because that's not sincere either.
Sure.
And so, yeah, I think that the thing that I found has been the best rudder for all that is just, what is my job? I'm here to work. Right. You know what I mean? I'm here to work and what is my job and what's the best thing that I can do to be prepared, to show up, have a great attitude, all that stuff. And just all the other, then that just allows for so much more cool stuff. But if I'm focused on any of the kind of the heady stuff, you know, then that will mess me up. You know what I mean? And it was great. Like when I got the gig with Ace and my buddy called me and he's like, he goes, dude, you know, you got the gig. He's freaking out. He goes, I have to pull over right now. And he pulled over his car and he just started screaming at me. He was so excited. And it was great because I was like, yeah, I go, it's really cool. He goes, what? What do you mean it's really cool? He goes, dude, we used to jump around your room. He's screaming at me. And I was like, thank you for reminding me how awesome this is. Because in my heart, I know, but I got 25 songs. Now I already know them all because I'm a Kiss fan, but I got to learn how they end them and what the tempos are. Like, I have work to do. And so that moment really helped me to just balance the fuck yeah, like the 14-year-old, like, yes, rock and roll. And then also, and now I'm going to do my work. You know, but to really celebrate and if you can have a balance and do good work, then you can have all that little kid fantasy stuff too, which is like freaking
my hat's
amazing.
Off to you. I mean, I got to meet Jeff Beck and hang with him, and that was amazing. He was one of my guitar heroes. That was really tough. When I got in the car and drove away from his house, I was like, ah!
Yeah.
But the whole time I was like, oh, you know, I'm trying to be really, you know, okay, thank
you.
And, but I freaked out. But the one thing, I don't know, because it's never happened to me, but, you know, growing up the world's biggest Queen fan, I don't know how I'd react around Brian May.
Yeah.
that's a real tough one for me because it's Brian May, it's Queen, and anybody who watches this channel knows I'm a hugest Queen fan. I mean, Beatles and Zeppelin like everybody else or all the other classics, but there's something about that because that was the first ever rock and roll album I ever heard.
Yeah.
Like you start off with Kiss, I start off with Queen. It's just in your blood. It's right. never going to change. And what's interesting as we get older, it just hardens. The more you love as a kid that touched you, you love even more, even more, even more.
Right.
It doesn't go away.
No.
It's like, first time I heard Highway to Hell, that will never go away.
No.
And of the two albums, Highway to Hell and Back in Black, love Back in Black. It's amazing. It's biggest selling rock album of all time. But Highway to Hell.
Yeah.
There's just something dirty about that. Just like, oh.
Yeah.
First time I ever heard that. And, you know, it's Bon Scott as well.
For me, it was Dirty Deeds. So I had Highway to Hell, but Dirty Deeds, there's something about that record. It's just so nasty.
Well, I heard Highway to Hell first and went back because I bought that song. If it's on camera, Touch Too Much.
Yeah.
7-inch single there.
Mm-hmm.
I bought that and played it to death as a kid.
Yeah.
So that's why I lost it. I lost a whole record collection in England. It's a long story. When I moved over here, it got completely stolen. But I try to go back and rebuy like you were doing with the Sean Cassidy. I go back and buy the things that really meant something.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people are going to be watching, especially the drummers, are going to want to know some detail stuff. They're going to want to know how exactly did you transition from being like local guy playing in bands in Connecticut, doing that, to get to play sessions and be a touring drummer?
Yeah. I think the pieces along the way is one, think big. You know, when I got into Kiss, I opened up Kiss Alive 2 and there's just fire and, you know, just sparks. And I want to be in that. Right. That's all I want to do. And I would go see my guidance counselor at ninth grade, you know, 9 through 12. They say, so what would you like to
have a guidance counselor?
Yes. Miss Castle. And
huge personality.
Yes. Very, very nice lady. And so I can remember the sweater. So, but she would say, so what do you
Matt's a rock guy.
What do you want to do? And I said, you know, I want to play rock and roll. And so she go, oh, well, we have these schools. And I said, you know, I don't want to go to school. I didn't show her the Kiss album, but I want to be in there. You know what I mean? And now, and I will say this too, because I talk to a lot of music schools, probably about, of all the friends that I have that are working in bands that everybody knows who they are, probably about 60% of them are formally educated in music. That wasn't my path, but so I don't have an opinion on that. But for me, I just wanted to play rock and roll. That's all I wanted to do. And so that never went away and I never let anybody dissuade me from that. And if they said it's not going to happen or something, that just didn't register. Mm-hmm. We had had a family picnic one year and this woman from New York City, a friend of our aunt, she was an actress and she came up and my mom said, oh, she lives in New York. And so she'll tell you how it really is. And she told me you might have to live in your car and all this stuff. And then my mom came up after and she goes, so do you still want to play music? And I said, yeah. Like,
yeah,
oh, that was
car.
Supposed to get me to, I don't care about that. Like, it just, nothing was going to dissuade me from doing that. It was in my heart. And so that spark's like a little baby. There's so much potential and power in there, but if you leave it unattended, it will just go away.
I think for me, it was an endorphin rush of me and my oldest friend in England, a kid called Steve Collings.
Mm-hmm.
He had a Maxwin drum kit, which is like the cheapest version. It's even cheaper than a Pearl Export, but it was Pearl's like entry-level kit. I think it was an orange Maxwin drum kit.
Mm-hmm.
I had a homemade guitar that my father made me and a Fal, F-A-L, amp that was probably a bass amp because there was no way to distort it, and a Carlsberg Suzz pedal, which was the cheapest distortion pedal, the only one I could afford.
Yeah.
And I just remember, you know, I was practicing and learning riffs and stuff like that. I just remember that one day, that one moment when it just locked and we were playing an AC/DC track.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, and we were playing TNT, just, you know, down, dum, 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 dum. We're playing TNT and it just locked between the two of us.
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe it wasn't the tights, but there was this endorphin rush.
Yeah.
And it was just almost like an out-of-body experience when it first happened. I remember that moment so well of just being like, I want to do this for the rest of my life. I just want music. And it's pretty crazy. And then the other moment I remember is listening to A Night at the Opera, the first rock and roll album I ever got that my dad bought me for Christmas in 1975.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember looking at the same thing, looking at all of the pictures and the picture, sleeve on the inside of all the pictures of the band and all this kind of stuff. and reading all the notes. And I had headphones on listening to it over and over again. Mm-hmm. And that was the other endorphin rush. It was like that. And the next time I felt that way again was just locking in with the drummer. And,
yeah.
Oh, it's almost like an addict. It's like I'm chasing that high every day of my life.
Right.
Just trying to remember that feeling and get it back. And it happens all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the great thing.
And it's not always with the big famous guys or girls. It's just like there's just moments when you're making music mm-hmm. on any level and it just feels so good. It can be me playing G, C, and D acoustic part against a track. Mm-hmm. And when it just locks and just feels good and it's swinging and it's grooving, I don't know how to explain it. It just feels fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you're always chasing that. For me, sonically, there was a thing called the Italian Fest in Hartford, Connecticut every year. And bands would play on the stages and on the sidewalk. And there was a band called Sinus Galley. And they were set up on the sidewalk and the guy had a full Marshall stack. And I heard and just that, I was like, what the hell is this? Because I was into Motley Crue and stuff. And so, you know, that's
you didn't know Communication Breakdown?
That was my version of Communication Breakdown for y'all.
Which I guess. It's yeah. Okay.
And I'd not heard things that primal yet. You know what I mean? Like I was into 80s and 70s, but 70s is still homogenized. That to go back again when that black music just turned white, it was like that thing. And I was like, what is it? And it took me like 3 years to figure out what that song was. And I've told this story a million times. And last year I was back in Connecticut and someone was saying, oh yeah, Bob, on this guy, he used to play in a band. I don't know if you ever heard of him, called Sinus Galley. I said, are you the original guy? He goes, yeah. I go, did you have a Marshall stack? He goes, yeah. And you played the Italian festival, yeah. And I just hugged him. And I was like, you changed my life. You know what I mean? Like, I've been waiting to meet you. And that was as profound as meeting Ace Frehley. You know what I mean? It was just like, dude, you were just doing what you had to do. Go make your parents buy you that Marshall stack and lug it around in their car with your Les Paul. But man, it was just like, when I heard that, it was just something so sexy
fantastic.
And powerful. So getting bitten by that bug, then always knowing in my heart, I can do this. I'm good enough to do this, but also constantly wanting to get better. And mm-hmm. so it never mattered to me, you know, well, this is just a rehearsal or there aren't, you know, that, oh, there aren't many people here tonight. That doesn't matter to me. That doesn't matter to me. I, you know, there's rock gods up in heaven that I'm playing for. You know what I mean? Sure. I don't care. And I remember hearing a quote actually from Kiss that Peter Criss, the drummer, would always say, where they'd be in some bar and there'd be nobody there. And he'd go, we're not playing here. We're at the Garden. We're playing Madison Square Garden. That's where we are. And that was something that just resonated with me. So
Keith Richards has two quotes I love. A gig is worth 1,000 rehearsals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And playing in front of an audience is easier than playing in front of one person.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So just setting that internal bar. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Just having that internal bar. So again, that genuine confidence, but then at the same time the humility that like I just want to keep getting better. There were two drummers in my town, you know, the drummers with the kits and the drummers with the rototoms. The rototoms like Neil Peart. And so that just didn't resonate with me. And so, you know, I work on some soloing stuff, but for me, there's certain feels that I'm just still chasing, you know, Highway to Hell. It just feels amazing, you know. Keep a Knockin', the Little Richard tune. Like Earl Palmer, that feel is just unbelievable. So to me, it's those things that are really the most exciting to me. And so I'm still chasing that stuff. And so always trying to get better. And sometimes what I get better just by listening, which is an interesting thing, you know. But I think just having that bug and then just having the confidence, knowing in my heart that I'm capable of doing this, but always trying to be better and just how can I bring my best self to this and looking at it as a job, because I think like most musicians and probably most people, I don't know, but I did not ever want a job, you know, and I went for years saying, oh, I haven't worked since I was 20. Well, that's not true. Mm-hmm. I've been working my whole, you know, at 14, I wanted a drum set. My dad said, oh, really? Okay. And then my mom and him sat me down and said, we know we were talking and you want some drums. And I'm like, oh, they're going to buy me a drum set. Do you know Marianne Benson and her husband, they own a coffee shop and you can work on the weekends. And I was like, okay. So, you know, I started washing dishes and I bought a hi-hat. And my dad bought me a snare. Bought me a snare and a stand. And then I bought a hi-hat. And then I bought a kick pedal. I didn't have a kick drum, but I bought a pedal. You know what I mean? And like just piece by piece. So
you know, just being willing to work towards these things and just keep moving forward, you know? And logistically, like nowadays, how do you get gigs? You know, I do a lot of career counseling and I talk about this stuff all the time. And it's about networking. It is about who you know, but it's also having the goods when that opportunity comes. You know what I mean? And so it's like, it's about who you know. And so you need to be everywhere all the time. That's how I put it, you know. And maybe the city that you're living in is okay. You know, that there can be an advantage to that, but you want to get around the people that are doing it, and you want to get around the people that are doing it successfully, you know? And so reach for those people. And nowadays it's really easy to
I want to qualify that statement though, because it, you definitely have to be around people that can take your musical skills, whether it be producer, engineer, drummer, guitar player, bass player, and utilize them in the best way. But you can't get in front of those people until you're really good at what you're doing and you've done a lot. See, for me as a producer and engineer and a songwriter, I had to have music that was good enough to say, hey, I recorded and produced and engineered this to be able to give to somebody.
Right.
Only reason why I wanted to say that is because I get a little fearful, because a lot of people go, oh, they only make money of this because they have friends. It's like, no, my friends, you're my friend.
Right.
But we're friends because we work on music together. You know, and we became friends because of it. People I work with are my friends, you mm-hmm. know, but I don't, we wouldn't be in the same room if we weren't qualified to do the job. I wouldn't have got the Ace gig if I hadn't done the Aerosmith gig. I wouldn't have done the Aerosmith gig if I hadn't done cheap demos for Jack. I wouldn't have been able to do cheap demos for Jack if I didn't start my own recording studio, which then grew into something that he came and recorded at.
Right.
So I had to work and build on my own with no formal education like yourself, no startup money. I had to build a 4-track recording studio business mm-hmm. into an ADAT recording studio business, into a basic Pro Tools studio that Jack Douglas wanted to do a cheap demo at, and came in and hired the studio. And I did a good enough job that he said, okay, now you can engineer an Aerosmith record.
Yeah. Yeah, and what I want to clarify too is what I was saying is getting around those people to learn from them.
Sure.
So that is what I'm saying. So like, you know, if I'm, you know, have an opportunity to hang out with Kenny Aronoff, I'm not going to ask him for work. I'm going to watch him. How does he talk? Sure. How does he walk? How does he think?
Do you know the Kenny story with Mellencamp?
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's the biggest one. That was the one I read that in Modern Drummer where
repeat it cuz
yeah, so he's working with John and they get a deal and they go in the studio. And after one day or 2 days, Kenny's fired. He's off the record, you know? And he figures, well, I can either like, he goes, if I don't stay in this, I'm never going to move forward. I'm just going to keep going backwards. So he said, can I come to the studio and watch the guy who's replacing me? Watch how he's doing it. Cause what am I not doing? You know? And he realized that. And then he, you know, fast forward 5-10 years, he's the most, you know, prolific studio drummer of those eras, you know? So that was a huge thing. And
I think it was 2 albums as well.
2 albums that he was not. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
I think he had to sit through 2 albums.
Yeah. And so that's the humility and the hard work, you know what I mean? And knowing mm-hmm. that again, speaking for him, he's going, I can do this, mm-hmm. but obviously they don't think I can. Maybe I'm missing something. Let me see. To sit and watch that, you know, like the guy's doing your gig, he's taking your paycheck. It's like the whole deal. You know what I mean? So getting around those people to learn from them. And I just wrote an article for Drumhead magazine, Jonathan Movers magazine. He said, I'd like you to do a column about things that have, you know, like lessons that you've learned. I said, okay, number one lesson. I was hanging out with Kenny maybe a couple years ago with this little bar. Guy got up to sit in. Guy was not a professional. Guy called out the tune. Kenny started playing it. Tempo was great. And the guy was nervous, as singers get, and wanted it faster. And he barked at Kenny, pick it up. Come on, pick it up. And Kenny just smiled and sped it up. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I just had a light bulb go off. I go, that's what he does. When his artist tells him to do this or that, he happily delivers. And sometimes that artist is John Fogerty, and sometimes that artist is this drunk slob guy at a bar. It doesn't matter to him. Yeah. He does. That's what he does. That's how he rolls. Another thing, I did a record with this producer, Jimmy Breilauer, and he worked with Mick Jagger. And I said, tell me something. He goes, well, when I would ask Mick, like, hey, this bit, what are you going to sing? He goes, Mick would get up and do the dance, the whole thing. Like, Mick never went, well, I'm going to sing Start Me Up. When he's singing, he's full on Mick, moving right. The whole thing. There's no, oh, this is in rehearsal mode or I'm in explaining mode. It's just boom, that guy all the time, you know? So that's another thing. Just, you know, they call it bringing your A game or whatever, but it's just, oh, I'll do it when it's a packed house. I'll do it. No, it's not dependent on outside circumstances. It's just me, you sure. know? And if someone says, oh, you were amazing tonight, I go, thank you very much. Now, if I know that I didn't play so great, I'm not going to burden them with that. I just say, thank you. But in my mind, what can I improve on? How can I sure. be better? And so, yeah, just getting around the successful people and watching what they do and learning and not asking them for something, you know, really, what can you bring to the situation? You know, what can I bring? So if I'm going to go meet with somebody, like, well, what do I have to offer? You know, and if I don't have anything going on, well, then offer a compliment, you know, say, it's nice to meet you. And I love your work you do with this and better that, and just listen, you know, but don't ask to get, cause I get what you're thinking. I have people that message me, you know, from the
cause they hear the piece of they hear the piece of the story. That's the easiest solution.
Right.
That's the unfortunate thing. It's like one of the big reasons why, not even the big reasons, the main number one reason why I started doing this channel was to, because my journey was what we all have to do now.
Right.
It was such a different, when I started, it was everybody, all the A&R staff at the labels were all their dad, their uncle or whatever got them a job because it was like kind of a shoe-in.
Yeah.
And all of the A&R guys had like two or three favorite producers or one or two and one or two favorite mixers. And they produced every record and mixed everything.
Yeah.
No matter how good the demos were that came in, they would just automatically re-record them and automatically remix them.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was the business because the checks were so huge that the one album that sold 10 million copies paid for the other 100 that didn't.
Mm-hmm.
It was simple as that. Now the industry's completely changed. So I thought to myself, this is the perfect time to do a channel like this and help. Because the way I came up, which was the banging your head against a brick wall countless times way of doing things, not having the friends that just kind of like threw me the gigs.
Right.
You know, like, oh yeah, just do this. Not having that kind of thing is where we're at now.
Right.
Now it's all about proving yourself. But because the technology has come to a level now, is great level where anybody with literally a cell phone, a laptop, or whatever can make great music.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's leveled the playing field. Now creativity is king beyond anything else. It always was, of course.
Yeah.
You know, it's just to say quickly, look at the Beatles. They were signed to a comedy label.
Mm-hmm.
And George Martin had, you know, recorded some music, but was mainly doing like the goon, spoken word stuff with musical stuff like that.
Right.
He took a chance as an A&R guy and a producer and signed. He was their A&R guy.
Mm-hmm.
Signed the Beatles. And now, of course, the Beatles are the most influential set of musicians ever and will never be surpassed. I mean, it's just, so that came out of left of center, not any traditional ways whatsoever. Then flash forward to Nirvana. Nirvana came along and blew out all the big hair metal bands and changed the music industry in the 90s forever from a little label called Sub Pop.
Right.
And so, you know, and they weren't mainstream heavy rock. So it's always come that way. You know, it's never been decided. And I think that's just a metaphor for us. We have to work hard. We have to be creative. We have to think outside the box.
Yeah.
But you have to have the goods to back it up. You have to work hard.
Yeah, and I think, well, as intellectual beings, which thankfully we are, which separates us from, you know, the animals, is, you know, you want to look at a situation and go, well, what's the thing? So, okay, the Beatles. Oh, I need to sign with a comedy label. Or Nirvana. Oh, I need to be on an indie label. And it's like, no. That's an interesting little point.
Sure.
But I think that what the broader point is there is no one way to do it. And it's just about doing the work and getting out there.
I must interrupt for 1 second because I love this. In I think it's in Outliers, the Malcolm Gladwell book.
Right.
He talks about the Beatles playing in Hamburg when they were doing those 12, 15-hour shifts, 6, 7 days a week for months on end.
Right.
And he said that by the time the Beatles recorded their first album, they had already played live longer than U2 have done in their whole career.
Yeah.
So not surprising that, you know, we talked about the Shea Stadium gig. Mm-hmm. They can't even hear themselves, but you listen to the recordings and their harmonies are perfect.
Because, no altitude.
Yeah.
No Melodyne in those days.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That we know of. Yeah, you know what I mean? And I think, you know, yeah, it's about doing the work and putting yourself out there.
Sure.
You know, and not relying on somebody to, you know, come in and save you. Just to let go of any of the bullshit, any of the myths that we tell ourselves. Okay. Because when I got back into drumming, I was 38. Okay. When I was a kid, I thought married people were losers. I thought if you had kids, you couldn't play in rock and roll. I have two beautiful babies. I have a wife. We've been married 13 years. You know, I was 38 when I got back into it, which is way too old for rock and roll. Just let all that crap go and just do the work. And consistently put in the effort every day. Boom, boom, boom. How can I up my game? How can I broaden my network? Just keep doing it and it will happen. You just got to keep pushing. And then you look back and go, whoa, I was here. Now I'm here. Okay. That's proof. You know, sure. I don't know how it works. It just does. You know, so that's really the thing. And just get out of your room, get out of your house, post what you're doing, let people know who you are, you know? And if you can't get along with people, it doesn't mean you're an artist. It means you're a pain in the ass, and that's going to prevent your work. So that's a really huge bit.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. And again, I was that guy. I was, you know, I was smarter than everybody else, and everyone else was in it. And it's like, yeah, not a lot of productivity happening then.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's a helpful thing too. Some of this comes with age, thankfully, but yes. You know, some people get it right away. You know what I mean? And sometimes it takes longer.
Well, to be the smartest person in the room, sometimes it means that you have to be quiet.
Right.
Because there's so many stories and conversations about massively successful entrepreneurs, and I read all those things, probably like you do as well. Mm-hmm. And one of the common denominators is they usually talk the least at meetings and take notes.
Mm-hmm.
So even when they're meeting some young up-and-coming entrepreneur who's really eager to meet them, they ask more questions of the young guy.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
You hear that all the time with entrepreneurs, that they spend more time listening and making notes and going, oh, so you wanted to meet me. Why?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like you learn. It's
learning.
You know, what is that? I don't know what Greek, Latin, I don't know what the proverb, who said it now? Sorry. All I know is I know nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's be teachable.
That's a great place to start, is to be able to start that day with that. And that's why so many times, bowling is a great example. I am not a bowler.
I went bowling last night with my wife.
Oh, how'd you do?
Actually got my highest score ever.
Wow, nice.
Yeah.
When I go bowling—
This isn't very good.
When I go bowling, I will bowl a strike a couple times within the first few frames.
Yeah.
Then I start, oh, wait, what did I do? And I start trying to repeat it. But it's just that beginner's luck. Also, when people move here to LA, they go, oh, yeah, I just got here. And they find me. And they've been here for a week. And they're at, like, some great gig that everybody should be at. And I'm like, you're going to get a gig. Like, you're going to get a gig because you're here. You're fresh. You just got off the boat. You've been here a week. You've already found this spot where all the musicians are. You don't know anything. And so you're hungry and you're willing to just get out there. And then once we have some success or something, we think we know something. And it's like, mm-hmm. to just go, no, I know nothing. What's the next bit, you know? Right. A bit philosophical, but still effective, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Well, look, it's been amazing talking to you.
Likewise.
I really appreciate it. Oh, you know what? Dumb question. Let's keep it in. What's your main gear choice these days? What are you using?
For drums, Ludwigs, and always been Ludwig. So my set is a Legacy, which is a 3-ply. It's a recreation of the 70s,
nice.
The Maple. And so 26, 14, 16, 18. That'll change with gigs, but...
26, nice.
26, yeah. Which is, deceivingly, a lot of times people are kind of either super excited or super afraid of it because it's like, oh, it's going to sound like Zeppelin, or, oh, shoot, it's going to sound like Zeppelin. You know?
Right.
But it's actually very versatile, you know, which is...
Are you using double kick more often?
No, only if I have to. Oh, so okay. Like when I play with Mr. Big, there's certain songs you absolutely have to do it.
Right.
But no, I mean, I came up single and how I like to interact. It's less literal.
Are you using Ludwig snares as well?
Oh yeah, always. So but my favorite one right now is a 6.5 chrome over brass, mm-hmm. with die cast hoops. The Black Beauty 6.5 with die cast hoops is awesome. I have a 60s chrome over brass 5, mm-hmm. and I have a a Pioneer, which is the wood version of that drum, like a transition badge. It's like 62. And that's gorgeous. And that you can't, you could put a pillow on it and you still hear snare. It's like, it's just nice. Got so much tone. So, so that's it. Heads, I play Evans and I use the heavyweight on my snare, which is just incredible tone, super fat, super warm. I don't like things to be overly snappy. You know, I like them to be kind of tough. So like you said one time, you go, everything I play sounds tough. And I was like, thank you. But I like my sounds to be that way too. So pretty rich sounding. So that's on the snare. Coated G2 on top, which is a two-ply coated head. And coated on the bottom, single-ply G1. So just to get that warmth and that roundness. And I like to try and any muffling that might need to happen, I like to make that happen with the heads. So I'm not putting tape. I don't have an issue with putting stuff on, but try and just get there easily. Cymbals are Pisces, usually 2002s. You know, I do a lot of rock and they just...
Yeah.
They just shimmer over the guitars and the vocal. They just got that
thing. Combine Pisces with Zildjians, but I do like a Pisces ride because it's so bottom sounding to me. Mm-hmm. And the one thing I'll say about Pisces cymbals is I have to do less EQ on my overheads.
Yeah.
Because they don't have that...
Right.
Which is that 400, 350, 400 that you pull out of every piece of the drum kit that every mixer's ever done.
Yeah.
You don't have to do that with the overheads. Right. And if you do pull it out to make the toms come alive, it doesn't screw up your cymbal sound. It's like there's something about Pisces that sound like they're already EQ'd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I like that. You know, I like the. My idea is when I started out recording on four tracks and putting up a 58, and I'd play and go, "There's too much bass drum," and I'd be like, "Oh, then I have to move the mic or play more bass drum then." Or there's too much snare. Or there's too much cymbal is really like the rock guy thing. And so I had to EQ myself and balance myself and that, sure. You know, play a triplet and it sounds like hoodla, hoodla, hoodla. I'm like, well, your left hand is actually not hitting hard enough. So you're not getting the full triplet. Sure. So that's how I learned to, and, you know, you hear Zeppelin, they use, you know, Glyn Johns three mics or one mic or whatever. But when you try and do that with, you know, most modern cymbals, yeah, they're down in that 400 range. And so you can't, if you take that out, then the drums go away.
Yeah.
You know? But what Bonham was playing was a line that they're making now, the Giant Beat. They used to make those in the 70s. And they're like, kss, there's no bottom end. So
nice.
So when I heard that, and that was several years ago, I've always been just trying to frequency-wise get the cymbals away from the drums as much as possible. Yep. So I actually play the Power Crashes, which are a little higher in pitch and more higher frequency. So that there's just a great dynamic difference between the two.
Right.
You know, out the gate. And then, you know, just trying to get things to happen at the source rather than trying to fix it later or deal with it.
Sure.
So drums, cymbals, snare, sticks are Vader, just the best wood ever. And anything else?
No, that's great.
Yeah, those are the tools of the trade.
I just wondered because there'll be a lot of drummers watching that will probably want to know exactly what you use. But.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, 6.5 depth on snares just for the rock thing. When I use a thinner snare, it can be cool, but I always like that fatter,
sure.
Fatter tone. If we're talking drum nerd stuff, I like a 14-inch kick depth, not 16 or 18. Because the 14, that low end just gets out really quick. Like your kit in there is 14, like all the classic Ludwigs. The bottom end just gets out fast rather than boom. So if you hit just a kick drum and it goes boom, it's like, whoa, listen to that kick. But there's just a lot of extra crap in there you're not going to want.
Yeah.
So that 14, it just gets out fast. It's, you know, just something that's fun.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
My pleasure.
Really appreciate it. Okay, everybody, please leave any questions and comments below. I might throw him under the bus and make him answer them. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing. I hope we went through a lot of stuff for you there, of course. Please leave more questions and comments, and I'll speak to you again soon. Thank you.